You're getting down to finals time?
Yep, it's about around the corner.
Okay, are they still covering new material, or are they just reviewing the whole semester?
It's a review now.
Good. So what do you got for me today? Are we gonna, you gonna verbalize them? You can probably verbalize most any of them.
It's all Math Excel today.
Okay. You want to do it on my end or on your end?
I think on your end would be better.
Okay.
Some of the earlier chapters in the semester were pretty easy and I could do mentally.
Okay.
But I think it builds up to the current chapter.
You're out of it? You're not logged in right now?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. Let's see if I can quickly figure out how to do this. I can. I just got to do it. Where is this? It's right here. Oh, I see why it doesn't like that. It's a Word file. And if, remind me to save it at the end. Sometimes if I'm on my end and I don't save it, you don't get credit for all the problems we did. All right, hold on a moment. Let me put these side by side. Let me close that out. Let me put this on the left and this on the right. What's the best way to do this division? Did you already do it? It looks like you did it. Oh yeah, we don't want to do this problem. What problem should I go to? James?
Yeah.
What problem
would
you like me to go to?
I don't think it's working right because we did all the problems on this one. And it took you directly to 11.3 instead of taking you to the home page.
Yeah, it seems like we had this problem last time also.
Yeah, so I'm going to have to sign in on my end.
Okay, hold on. Let me sign out. Guess I don't need to worry about saving this, but how do I sign out? Go to Overview?
Go to My Name, and there's a drop-down menu.
Okay. Now all of a sudden I don't have your name anymore. I hope if I log out without signing out, it's oh here, hold on. Go to your name, log out, leave this page. Okay, I'm out of it.
Okay.
Go ahead and log in, and then you can just read the problems to me. Be honest with you, I kind of prefer that. I prefer it when you're reading the problems to me. I think the tutoring session goes a little bit better. Keeps you more involved also.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to just having me do it and kind of do it on my end and tell you what I'm doing. This way, it definitely keeps you more involved.
Oh, one second. Almost there.
Yeah, that's fine. Go ahead.
Solve the equation by finding square roots.
Okay.
It is 99b squared. Equals 11.
Okay. What's the first step? We're trying to solve for B. We got to get rid of anything that's added or subtracted or multiplying or dividing B.
So probably divide B.
Divide both sides by what?
99.
Okay. That's the first step. Now that leaves B squared equals, notice that that is 1/9. 11 over 99?
Yeah.
Now you're going to solve this equation by taking the square root of both sides. It's the only way to solve it. Well, when I take the square root of both sides, the left side becomes B. That's my goal. I've isolated B. What's the square root of 1/9?
Wouldn't that be timesing it by the reciprocal?
No. First of all, let's talk about the general case. If I have the square root of A over B, that's the same as the square root of A over the square root of B. So let's first of all do that. What's the square root of 1/9 equal to? Separate it into a numerator and a denominator.
So then radical 1 over radical 9?
What's radical 1 equal?
Just 1.
What's radical 9 equal?
3.
That's your answer. And notice that 1/3 times 1/3 is equal to 1/9.
Mm-hmm.
This highlights a property of numbers that's very important. And that is that when you take the square root of a number that's greater than 1, it gets smaller, right? If I take the square root of 4, it's 2. If I take the square root of a number that's between 0 and 1, it gets bigger. Notice that the square root of 1/9 became 1/3. Well, 1/3 is much bigger than 1/9.
Right.
And it's the same principle in reverse. If I take a number greater than 1 and I square it, it becomes greater than x. In other words, if I'm squaring 3, it gets bigger. It becomes 9. But if I'm squaring a number that's between 0 and 1, if I square 1/4, that's between 0 and 1, it becomes 1/16, much smaller. When I square a fraction that's less than 1, it gets smaller. And the reverse is true. When I take the square root of a fraction that's less than 1, it gets bigger. And it's really hard. This is a difficult problem for most people. If I said, what's the square root of 1/9? Most of my students wouldn't get that. But
yeah.
It becomes much easier if you break it up into the square root of 1 over the square root of 9. Then it becomes, you don't even have to think about it. You know that that's 1 and that's 3. But you can think the other way. You just have to kind of get used to it. If I said to you, what is the square root of 1/4? What is that?
That's 1/2.
Yeah, a number bigger than 1/4. And that's what most people don't want to do, is they don't want to consider any numbers bigger than the one they're taking the square root of. Because most people think that when you take the square root of any number, it gets smaller. But it's not true. It doesn't, if it's between 0 and 1, it doesn't get smaller. All right, what else you got?
So should I put 1/3 in the math Excel?
Yeah. No, for sure.
It says it's wrong.
It's plus or minus 1/3, excuse me.
Okay.
Because what we had was x squared equals 1/9. So when I took the square root of it, It's always, when you solve an equation by taking the square root of a number, always, always, always start your answer out with plus or minus.
Okay, there we go.
Okay. What's next?
I
forget to do that as often as my students do, but I guarantee you that my students forget to do it 99% of the time. Everybody forgets that plus or minus. And you're always going to lose points on a test if you do forget it.
Right. It's the same type of problem. It's 4r squared minus 100 equals 0.
All right. Two ways to do this problem. Let's do it the normal way, and then I'll show you the advantage of doing it maybe a different way. First thing I'm going to do.
First thing is to get the 4r squared by itself by adding 100 over.
Okay, so I got 4r squared equals 100. What's second thing? Trying to isolate r.
Oh, right, yeah, so divide 4r squared by 4 and 100 by 4, and I know off the top of my head that's 25, so and the square root of 25 is 5.
No. Remember, when you take the square root of both sides to solve an equation, your answer always is plus or minus 5.
Oh, that's right.
Notice why. The reason is that minus 5 times minus 5 is equal to plus 25. Minus 5 is every bit as legit as plus 5 is. Every bit as equal as a solution. So if you put only plus 5, you're leaving out 50% of the solution. That's how important it is to put that plus or minus 5. Now,
but definitely forget that.
Well, here's a way that you never forget it if you do this problem a little different. Notice we have the difference of perfect squares. 4r squared is a perfect square. It's 2r times 2r. And 100 is a perfect square. It's 10 times 10. So this factors into 2r minus 10 times 2r plus 10. If I use difference of perfect squares to solve this. Now, when I solve that, I get r equals 5, and when I solve that, I get r equals minus 5. So there's my two solutions, and I didn't have any chance to make a mistake even, because I solved it using difference of perfect squares instead of square root. And now I know the instruction said solve these by taking the square roots of both sides, but this is kind of an example where you could see that it's better to do it the hard way because it eliminates the possibility of you making that very, very common mistake.
Right.
And also, the other way to do it, let me just mention it, is I could divide everything by 4 right off the get-go so that I have this. And that's still difference of perfect squares. R minus 5 times R plus 5. And now, again, I get both my proper solutions, 5 and minus 5. So there's really three ways to do it. I prefer the first because it's the quickest way, but it's also the way that is most likely to get you an error because it's so easy to forget that plus or minus sign.
Right, so it's either do the harder way, but then you remember.
Yeah, if you do it the harder way, you're going to get it right all the time.
Okay.
You do it the easy way, you just have to remember that whenever you solve an equation by taking the square root of both sides, your answer always begins plus or minus.
Okay.
And that's what you kind of, I don't know how else to teach that. I, you know, it's hard. There's no little song. They make up a little song to teach you the quadratic formula, but I've never heard anybody make up a song to teach you that principle. Yet I wish there was one, because everybody needs it.
Right.
All right. What else do we
Here's one that's factoring.
Okay.
It's 5w squared. Minus 36w equals 32.
All right. This has a w squared term, it has a w term, and it has a number. So typically, in fact, 100% of the time, we're always going to solve these the same way. What are we going to do as a first step?
We would first look if there's a greatest common factor.
Especially when they tell you it's a factoring problem.
We'd look for a common factor between all the numbers.
And there is not one.
Right.
So the standard way to solve quadratics is to make sure that one side is zero. In other words, let's subtract 32 from both sides, leaving zero over here. And that is a key part of the process, very key. And now the reason that's so important is because we're going to separate this quadratic into two linear factors. We're going to have one factor times another. Okay? And if I have two things multiplied together that are equal to zero, I can set both of those things equal to zero. In other words, by definition, one of them has to be zero. You can't multiply two numbers together and get zero unless one of them is zero. So that's why this is a factoring problem. If I can split this quadratic into two linear factors, I can solve it. Well, let's start. What's step one of splitting it up? Split up that term right there. It's only one way to split that up.
And how do we do that?
Well, we're looking for two things. You always want to split up the W part. Okay? So, I mean, some people might say, well, what if I said this? That splits it up. But you never want to split it up that way. You always want to split up the W. Well, what if I have 5W times W? That's what makes up this first term, when I multiply these two linear terms back together again. So that's what you have to make sure, is that you're always producing something that's going to produce this term when I multiply it together. And 5w times w is 5w squared. Now, the next step, what are both signs? It's always step two.
What are what?
Both signs. In other words, the sign that separates that from a number and the sign that separates that one from a number. What are they?
Negative.
They have to be opposite, correct?
Correct.
Because they are what produces that number. Well, that number is a negative 32. The only way you can produce a negative is if you have a positive and a negative. If I had two positives, that would be a plus. If I had two negatives, that would be a plus. So I have to have opposite signs. Well, this is a much harder quadratic to factor because that's not one. Okay? So this is definitely higher level quadratics. This becomes a trial and error process. And in fact, plus minus is not even the same as minus plus. It's different. So I have to allow for both. And I do it this way. This is my personal way of doing it.
Okay.
Now, step three. That's step one and two. Step three, or we need factors of 32. And that's it. There's no rules like they have to add to 36 or they have to subtract the 36. The moment that we have a coefficient different than 1, You can throw all of those rules out the window. The only rule that we keep is has to be factors of 32. Well, let's list all the factors of 32. What's the next one? Let me show you how I find all factors.
16 and 2.
That's the way I do it. I cut that in half and double that. Can I do it again? Cut that in half and double that?
Do 8 and 4.
Can I do it again? I can, but it produces the same two factors. So right. I haven't accomplished anything. Okay. So from what I can see, that's it. There's no other factors that multiply to 32. I can't think of any, at least. No, that's it. It's not divisible by 3. So my general rule of thumb when I'm dealing with difficult quadratics, difficult defined as being a number other than 1 in front of the squared term, I'm always going to choose the factors that are closest together to begin with. Let's try this, 8 and 4.
Okay.
What does that produce as a middle term? And the only way to figure it out is to do these double smiley faces.
To multiply them?
Well, multiply, in other words, remember FOIL?
Mm-hmm.
These double smiley faces are the O and the I of FOIL. And they are what produces this middle term, minus 36W. So I have to do the inside and the outside to figure out whether I get minus 36W. Well, the inside is plus 8W. The outside is minus 20W. Well, those add to minus 12W. That's obviously not my solution, right? We got to get minus 36W. Well,
right.
The principle, if I move that 8 down to the negative sign and the 4 down to the positive sign, I'm going to get the same 12. It's just going to have a plus sign on it instead of a negative. And that's an important thing to consider because I don't have to try that. In other words, I didn't get the right number. If I'd have gotten the right number, wrong sign, then I just have to move them down and I'll be fine. But the only other thing to try is to put the 4 there and the 8 there. In fact, let me do it intentionally wrong and I'll show you what I mean. I'm going to put the 4 there and the 8 there. Now, what middle term does that produce?
4 there and the 8.
What's the inside term?
Negative 4W.
The outside term?
40W.
Notice that that adds to 36W. We got the right number, but the wrong sign. That means is all I have to do is move this number up to the plus, this number up to the minus, and I'll have the right answer.
So the 4 to the plus and the 8 to the negative.
Yeah, and you can only do that when you come up with the right number, wrong sign. Now, notice what I get. I get plus 4W minus 40W minus 36W, bingo. Now, I know they said the problem was a factoring problem. And incidentally, had 4 and 8 not worked, then the next thing I'm going to try is 16 and 2. I'm going to go to the next closest together. The last thing I'm going to try is 32 and 1. And it is a trial and error process, but I would say 99% of the problems they give, to Colorado students at least, always involve the two factors that are closest together, which makes for much easier problem solving because it's trial and error and you don't want to have to go through all the combinations. So if you start, go ahead.
Why would you do the 16 and the 2 before you would do the 32 and 1?
Because they're closer together. 16 and 2 are closer together than 32 and 1.
Okay.
That's what I meant. In other words, we had 32 and 1, we had 6 and 2, and we had 8 and 4. Well, 8 and 4 are closest together of any of those three pairs. The two numbers, the two factors are closer together. That's why I started trying that. And I'm going to try all four combinations. But we realize we really don't have to try four combinations. We only have to try two. I got away with only trying two combinations, and you're always going to get away with only trying two, because you don't have to try all four combinations. You know, if you get the wrong number, then there's no point in trying the combination where the four is with the negative sign and the eight is with the positive sign. You're going to get the same number, just the opposite sign. These are definitely much harder quadratics to factor, but not impossible, and not such that you need anything called the California method or anything like that. It's just a trial and error process. And the California method is also a trial and error process, or the diamond method, whatever they call that method there. They're no different. It's just that they're a little more complicated and a little more confusing as far as I'm concerned. I like my method better. I've always liked it better, and I've always resisted this California method. I don't think it's a good way to teach factoring. We got a couple of minutes. Do you have another one? I don't have a lot of wiggle room. I have another session, but do you have something, another quadratic to factor?
Not right now.
Okay.
Or at least it might take me a little long to find one.
Okay. Well, yeah. Let's go ahead and end it then.
Okay.
And let me just check here. I think you have a Sunday session set up for 1 o'clock, correct?
I believe I do.
Yeah. 1 o'clock at the library. Okay. In fact, I've reserved the AFW room, but I'll just meet you at the top of the stairs like normal.
Okay, that sounds good.
All right. See you Sunday, James.
All right, sounds good.
Bye-bye.
Bye.